Sophie for Culture Compass, and today I'm with Jake from Black Veil Brides. How are you?
Good, how are you?
Yeah, not too bad, thank you. You're quite an accident-prone group of lads, so how are you all doing at the moment? Are you all in one piece?
I think as far as I know, we're all in one piece right now.
That's good.
Yeah, it is good.
And you're quite, I'd say, ambitious as a band. You're always striving to improve, and in your lyrics and just in interviews, it seems that way. So did you have plans for 2012? Did you have, like, goals that you wanted to achieve?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think it's the same goals that we've had since we started the band. You know, we want to take over the world and just ultimately be the biggest band in the world. And, you know, we're never going to stop till that happens, whether it happens or not. But, you know, we're just... believe in what we do, and you know, just strive to write and record better songs and put on better shows, and you know, get more and more fans, and just continue to do what we're doing. It seems to be working, so we're definitely just going to keep doing what we do.
You never think you'll get complacent if you're at the top of your game and doing the stadium stuff. You never think you just rest on your laurels or anything like that.
No, I think we'll always try to outdo ourselves.
Always striving for more.
Yeah. We'll never be, oh yeah, this is good. This feels good here. Let's just call it, yeah, this is good. No, it'll always be, it's not good enough. It's not good enough. We need to make this better, this better. We have to do this. This has to be bigger. It's always going to have to be bigger.
Would you say you're perfectionists as well? Are you constantly tweaking things and looking back at things and saying we could have done that differently?
Absolutely. I am definitely, you know, as a guitar player recording guitars in the studio just alone, you know, it's different when you're recording an album and then 6 months after that's released and you're touring on that, the way you end up playing it live becomes so much more natural, and you wish you were able to record it that way, and you feel more, so much more comfortable playing it, I guess, for me. So a lot of the time I think, wow, I wish I could have recorded it like this, but I guess, you know, it's already done, it's out, you can't, and you just have to, you know, I guess it's kind of a cool thing too, because when the fans come see you live, they get to see the little different kind of things you do live instead of how it sounds on the album if they pick that up.
Keeps it fresh, doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
And also, when you look back on the second album, which was released last year, you said it was almost based on the reactions to the first one, the decisions you made. So how do you think it will affect the next album, maybe things that you've noticed that fans have picked up on?
I mean, you know, the first record was basically, you know, the lyrics more about kind of, you know, takes believe in yourself, that kind of thing. The second one is more of, all right, well, take that and go grab the world by the throat and take what you want from it, and you know, stick up for yourself, do that kind of thing. I think this one, you know, people evolve, people grow. You know, you can't write about the same thing all the time. It's like a lot of people relate to that. We all did as kids growing up, going through high school, getting picked on, whatever. I think this next one is just kind of really just going to be different. It's going to be darker. It's going to be, you know, what I don't get is like people, like the haters online or whatever, talk about like, oh, you guys are emo and blah, blah, blah. Like, okay, whatever.
You're just writing about life, aren't you, I guess?
I don't know what that is supposed to mean, because so many people have so many different takes on it, but... it's just really like when we're writing about experiences and, you know, having a dream and taking that and, you know, giving people positive hope, you know, it's a positive message in the end. I think the next record, you know, it's not going to stray away from that in any way, but it's going to be, I think lyrically it's going to be darker. It's going to be more back to the roots and maybe not so happy sounding,
okay. But
definitely catchy. I guess you could say that Coffin is a good, like from the Rebels EP, that's a good way that the album could go.
Okay.
Hopefully, I would love it to all go that way.
Do you think you're all on the same page, though, with how you want it to go? Is it sort of you have discussions and you debate things out with each other?
I think we're all on the same page. I think musically, I might have to kind of step in. Like, I know there was times where I kind of maybe made some of the guys in the band angry when I told them I don't like something. I may have not said it, I don't like it. I may have said it fucking sucks. But, you know, it's all for the best in the end. And if anyone were to say something that I came up with and say, that sucks, I don't like it, I wouldn't get pissed off. I would be like, okay, cool. Like, all right, well, thanks for telling me. But I may have said some things that piss people off. But basically, Coffin, we were trying to finish that song for the record, and I didn't like what was happening with it. And I said my piece about it, and it didn't get finished. And then when we came back and did it for the Rebels EP, it came out the way it should.
And everyone's happy with it now?
And everyone loves it. It's a huge song. It's great. And it's just, you know, sometimes you have to sacrifice making someone pissed off at you for saying your opinion, and instead of just agreeing and making something that's crap, you know? Mm. You know, it's for the best. Someone may be pissed for a second because their feelings get hurt, but in the end, it's going to come out a lot better.
And the thing is, you've got to play these songs for decades to come, so you've got to be happy with it, haven't you?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I don't want to be playing songs I'm not proud of, you know?
That's not a good life.
No. I would scratch that song and write a new one. So, yeah, you know, they've got to be great songs. Yeah. And something that we all believe in, you know? For me, it started out just writing just music, not lyrics or anything, just music, drums, bass, guitars, just everything that I want to listen to, something that I thought sounded cool and I wanted to listen to, and it's turned into all of this. So
you're becoming quite a phenomenon even, aren't you, now as a band?
Apparently. We've kind of been in our own bubble, and just, you know, we do what we do, humble people, you know, down to earth. And but it's kind of crazy. Like, you know, we came back from South America, and people there are like zombies trying to just tear us apart. Like, we can't even get from the venue doing soundcheck back to the van to go to the hotel. It's just being torn up, just like stuff ripped off of us, and like getting attacked, and there's security and gates and everything, and can't even get through them. And it's just a completely different experience. But I guess, you know, that comes with territory. It comes with...
It's the name of the game.
You know, you expect it to happen. Mm. You know, we never started... I guess everybody in this band didn't start playing music because they just... I don't want to be famous. I don't want to make a lot of money. I just want to be a humble music... No, you know, we... Obviously, music is what we love.
Yeah.
And... by no means are we rich and famous driving Ferraris and stuff. I live in an apartment in Los Angeles and have a piece of shit car. We're starting to do well enough where we can pay our bills, where it's not like struggling to eat, that kind of thing. So it is on the rise where we're doing better, which is nice. We don't have to work day jobs anymore. You know, I used to work horrible 9-to-5 jobs.
Like what?
Customer service, phone jobs, sales jobs. I worked for a company called CaliforniaPsychics.com.
Wow.
Like, I wasn't actually a psychic, but
damn.
Did like customer service, became a supervisor for the customer service team, got into psychic management. This is part that was funny. I got on salary for basically checking applications for people applying to be a psychic for the company, and it was my job to decide whether they were legit or not, and then set them up for test readings. And I basically just went online and watched movies all day.
Sounds superb.
I got fired 4 months later after they were like, all right, you're not really doing anything. Took you this long to figure that out? I hate this job. Yeah, so...
Life's improved then somewhat.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
But how do you cope with the things we were talking about earlier, like the attention from fans, maybe things written on the internet, weird tweets? How do you deal with that?
Sometimes it's hard, you know? Like, I guess for me personally, it's a thing where if somebody says something directly towards me, whatever, I don't care, it's not a big deal. You can go on our the band's Facebook page every day, and there'll be somebody there's these internet trolls, I guess they're called, and they're just always gonna have hate. It's funny, I read one the other day, somebody said, I don't know why I liked your page or why I liked any of your songs, you guys suck.
What's the point?
Why are you on our page? Why did you like our page? Why did you, like, on Facebook? Why are you liking our songs? You just said you liked our songs, but we suck? And now you're taking the time to leave this comment. There's been people that post YouTube videos of them having our t-shirt. Oh, I hate Black Veil Brides so much. And they go out and light our t-shirt on fire. This is how much I hate them. It's like, keep buying those t-shirts and burning them. Yeah. Keep doing it. It's awesome. I love it.
Would you rather have a reaction that's passionate though and strong?
Absolutely. Yeah. It's, you know, nobody wants to be mediocre, like, oh yeah, they're okay. It's either love us or hate us.
Yeah, that seems to be.
But it seems everybody's got something to say about it. So yeah. Love us or hate us. It's awesome.
It's good to be talked about at the end of the day, isn't
absolutely.
It?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I want to talk about also working with Josh Abraham. Because he's known for making quite epic songs, because he's worked with 30 Seconds to Mars, Linkin Park and stuff. But I know you were going to do interviews with other producers, and he pretty much stole the show straight away. So what was it about him that just confirmed it?
Basically what happened was we had a couple meetings before we did Set the World on Fire. And we then had the meeting with Josh Abraham, and we went into Pulse Recording in L.A., which is literally like 5-10 minutes away from my apartment, actually, and it's in Silver Lake. And went to his studio, and he basically had this team. He had Ryan, his engineer, this guy Luke, who's his vocal go-to guy, and then Josh, who's, you know, the big-time producer. And basically just didn't really know what we were going to do. Like, we had an idea, like, I don't know if we're going to, because we had done other meetings before, and it was like, are we going to record a song or what? Like, we worked with Marty Fredrickson, and did a couple songs with him, and great dude, really talented. Did a couple other meetings with some other producers, and it was really bad. Like,
shocking.
What? This was a waste of time. Mm-hmm. Okay. But we actually walked into a real professional studio. We're like, all right. And, you know, I went to an engineering school for audio engineering, and I recognized all the stuff. I'm like, all right, this is awesome. This looks good. Mm-hmm. And met everybody, his team, Luke, Ryan, and Josh. And they came in and just kind of, like, hung out for a bit, just talked a little bit, kind of like, yeah, you know. And, like, Josh Abraham's done, like, Slayer records and stuff, too. So it was, like, real metal. And, like... Yeah. All right, and I had my hard drive and just kind of hooked it up, pulled up a couple Pro Tools sessions, and like, yeah, here's a couple ideas we've got. And they listened, and it was kind of like, all right, and like, go back, play this other one. And it was my demo for Set the World on Fire, the music, and they're like, let's start on that. It's like, all right. So basically, Andy, Josh, Luke, and Ashley went into another completely different room and started coming up with vocal melodies for my demo as CC, Jinx, and I started tracking all the instrument stuff, like, in the studio. So, basically, that song was done in 2 days. And it just came out awesome, and we went home. And at the time, I was actually living with Andy. And we're just like, it's comfortable. They get what we're trying to do. They understand us. Like, we have to do the record with them. Mm-hmm. And Blasco, our manager, had all these other meetings set up, and we called him and just like, cancel everything. Like, let's just start the record. Let's do it. Let's just go for it.
Yeah.
And we did. And we got about halfway done. Then last year at the same time, we were on tour with the Murder Dolls over here for 2 weeks. We went back to LA, finished the record, and then went to Japan, and that big earthquake happened. Oh. And then tour, here we are.
Non-stop, isn't it?
Yeah.
So would you work with him again, or do you like to try and experiment and work with new people? Is that part of the fun for you?
Well, we actually when we did the Rebels EP, we recorded in the same place at Pulse Recording with Ryan, the engineer, and with Luke producing. Josh Abraham didn't have anything to do with that, but it was, you know, his studio, same team and everything. And Luke, like, you know, he's become a great friend. He's hung out with us, like, at my apartment and stuff, and he's a really cool guy. Ryan's a great engineer, just really talented. You know, normally it takes people, if not a whole day, to just get drum tones and set everything up. Mm-hmm. Took him 30 minutes, and it's just doom, doom. He tunes them himself, and
just the natural.
It's done, and it sounds awesome. Mm-hmm. I would like to work with other people just to get a different sounding record. You know, it can't all sound the same. I would like it to always sound bigger and bigger and bigger. So I have no idea where we're going to record the next one yet, but hopefully it'll be, I'm sure it'll be an awesome studio. I mean, yeah.
In LA, you're thinking probably.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it'll be in LA.
How does working in LA affect you though? Because obviously it's a sunny place. It's not grey skies like London. So does that affect your mood and how you create things?
Not really. I mean, you know, I mean, I guess I would say as far as like Jinx, Andy and I go, we're more like people to ourselves. We don't really like, we don't want to go out to clubs and bars and go party and mingle with the Hollywood people and everything. That's more like Ashley is definitely that kind of guy. Mm-hmm. He wants to go out and network and stuff. And, Cece's kind of a party animal, but, really, when I'm home in LA, I'm just kind of, I like to be by myself and just be alone. It's good to have alone time. Yeah. I mean, I think so.
Do you formulate a lot of ideas just sitting at home then? Do you just play on your guitar and just...
Yeah, I've got my Pro Tools recording rig at home, and I've got, you know, a lot of the ways I pre-pro drums, I'll just, you know, have my samples and build them on a grid in Pro Tools. I don't know if anybody will know what that means, but other ways I do it MIDI in Pro Tools and have my keyboard with my drum modules, the plugins in Pro Tools, where you can sit there, kick snare, and then go back over and do the cymbals and everything and then quantize it so it lines up and it's in time to a grid with the tempo. Just nerdy stuff, but
you enjoy it, that's the main thing.
Absolutely, I love it. I love being a music nerd. And then just recording guitars, and Jinx is that way too. You know, he's a classically trained violinist and he's a great guitar player, and we work together very well with different styles, but it's kind of like his brain will come up with what mine can't, and mine will come up with what his can't.
Yeah.
So it works very well.
Make up for each other's lackings.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. And I know your mum's a classic pianist, is that right? So do you run your music past her or ask her opinion when you have something?
She actually, the first time she saw me perform ever was on the Buried Alive Tour with Avenged Sevenfold at the Target Center in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And it's like I think it's got to be like a 15,000-20,000 cap arena. And so that was her first time ever seeing me perform. And she was very proud. I brought her and like some of my uncles and aunts and cousins backstage, and I got to hang out with them and went back to their hotel that they booked and got to talk to them for a long time. And you know, I talk to my mom when I can on the phone when I'm in the States and stuff. And I remember her telling me, you know, my sister sends her a lot of stuff, like magazines and CDs and stuff, and she got the Set the World on Fire record, and she listened to that, and I just remember telling me that she's like, yeah, I listen to it all, like, I actually have it, like, I listen to it like I do any of my other, like, she's very into country and stuff. She's like, I listen to it like any of my other CDs, and it's really, really good. She's like, you really took that guitar and perfected it. It's like, well, thanks. I haven't perfected it, but, you know, I'll work on it. But it made me feel really good when she said that, and, you know, it had been 6 years since I had seen her, and then first time she seen me performing in a huge arena, felt pretty awesome. So I heard from my cousin that on their way home that she was just bragging the whole time. So it's like
proud mums.
Yeah,
oh, that's nice.
Awesome.
Yeah, What do your friends from back home from when you were at school think of it? Are you like, no, to some of them, the ones that doubted you? Or?
Honestly, I it kind of sucks. You know, I've tried to keep in contact with them. Like, you know, when I went to finish high school in Minnesota, tried to keep in contact with them. And, you know, some of them would respond and stuff, and I get a hold of them, but they just couldn't really get in touch with them. And then, like, I don't even know if they, I have no idea if they even know what I'm doing. If they do, if they're just like, I don't know. Like, I've tried and tried and tried, and I just gave up because I'm like, I'm not gonna keep trying. Like,
shouldn't be an effort, should it, really?
Yeah, it's like, if you're interested, like, I'm showing an interest in your life that I'm so care about you people, like, you guys were my best friends in school, like, if you have no interest, then I'm just gonna give up. And, like, you know, I've got my band now, they're my best friends, and
yeah, concentrate on that.
Yeah. I'm not gonna waste my time trying to go to the past. It's like, I've tried, and alright. There was actually in Minneapolis, there was a couple people I went to high school with that I actually did get a hold of, and I was like, yeah, I'll put you on the guest list. And they actually came out, and it had been 7-8 years since I'd seen them. They actually did show up, so. And they weren't even like the friends that I was really great friends with, so I was like, well, that's cool, I respect that, you know, that's awesome you guys actually came out. And and then they actually missed our performance, and there was one guy who ended up coming to the Duluth show in Minnesota, and I just remember seeing a big sign, it's just like, had my name on it, and I looked out, and because they got backstage, and he's like, yeah, we should go to Duluth. And so this big sign out there with my name on it. And I was like, up on stage, like, yeah. I was like, all right. And he like saw me, he's like, yeah. Oh, so I was nice. Like, cool. Like,
heartwarming moment.
Yeah, I was like, all right. Do you Somebody try still to... remembers me from there. Yeah.
Do you always try and take note of the people that you see in the crowd all the time that follow you around and give them a wave or something like that?
When people come to so many shows over and over and over, you know, you start to see familiar faces. Yeah. But when you're playing all the time, it's like, really, like, people, do you remember me? Yeah,
you have to pretend, like, don't you?
It sometimes you do, sometimes just like, I'm sorry, I don't know. But
they don't like that usually, do they?
It's not good to lie and no, say okay. Yeah, I totally remember you, because then they're just gonna ask you, okay, well, prove, like,
could get very sticky.
Yeah, so it's like, I'm sorry, I just meet a lot of people, can you refresh my memory? I don't know.
Do your best.
It's hard sometimes. Yeah. Try our best.
And while I was researching for this interview, a lot of interviewers concentrated on the image, obviously, because it's quite a strong one. And from looking at what you say about it, it's mainly that you don't think there's enough real rock and rollers around anymore.
Well, I mean, it's you know, like the idols that so many people look up to, like, say, Sebastian Bach, Dee Snider, Nikki Sixx. For instance, Dee Snider, we met him at Bamboozle, and he came up to us. He watched us side stage the whole set, and he came up to us afterwards, and he was like, it's really good to see rock stars again, you know? It's good to be able to tell when the band shows up. And Nikki Sixx had said, we did an interview with him on his Sixth Sense Radio, and he was, you know, just telling us, like, you know, I hope a lot of people hate your band, because everybody hated Motley Crue when we came out, and now we're their favorite band.
Yeah, everyone cites, like, them as inspiration now, don't they? It's the cool thing.
Yeah, and it's like, now, oh, you're just a Motley Crue ripoff. Oh, you're just a Kiss ripoff. Okay, but have you listened to the music? Because it's absolutely nothing even close to either of those bands. I mean, it's got similarities, like guitar solos, but not even close. Right. So it's like, when people say that, I'm like, as an image thing, it's an inspiration, but listen to the music, it's nothing even close to that. How are we a ripoff band of them? So,
research, you know, your insults if you're going to do it.
Exactly. Mm. So people will say stuff and they just have no idea what they're talking about.
Yeah. Well, they're the silly ones then, aren't they?
Yeah.
So are there any people around that you do think you've got it, you've got that rock star thing going on? Because I know Marilyn Manson's been mentioned before. Oh, but anyone else more recent?
Marilyn Manson, you know, he's crazy. You know, he definitely, you know, the, he had his whole thing, you know, people protesting him. Like, I think what he did was awesome. I was never a big Marilyn Manson fan, but I think what he did was cool. And he, you know, is a very intellectual person. As far as recently, you know, I don't know.
The fact that you can't think of anyone says it all.
Yeah. Yeah, nothing really. Nobody that I'm really into, like, oh, they're doing this crazy thing. I mean, no, I don't know.
Because you're into Van Halen, Scorpions, old school mainly, aren't you? Yeah.
I mean, I guess, like, the band that I always give the most credit to would be Avenged Sevenfold.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I've been a fan of them. I love what they do, and they're awesome dudes that made me even a bigger fan of their band.
Yeah.
And, you know, just their style, you know, it's very Iron Maiden, Pantera, you know, just kind of...
It's got some guts, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's got some balls to it, mm-hmm. but it's... I don't know, at the same time, it's like... When they first started out, they were kind of, like... It was funny, when we were on tour with them, Zachy said to us, it's like, you guys have some big balls doing what you're doing, like... It's like, when we came out, we got so much shit for just, you know, they wore a little bit of eyeliner and stuff and, like, tattoos and looked kind of crazy. It's like, you guys, like, he's like, even Sin, Brian, he asked me, he's like, I know you probably get asked this all, this is like the first night we hung out, he's like, I know you probably get asked this all the time, but I just got to ask, how long does it take you guys to, like, get ready? And, you know, just answer, and, but they just seemed, like, very respectful. Like, you guys have some big balls doing what you're doing. And we think it's awesome. And, like, we're actually a fan of your band. And, like, they, like, listened to our record the whole way through. They were listening to the Rebels EP. And they're like, yeah, we want to hear that. And then, like, listen to it. And, like, Brian Sin offered. And he's like, yeah, we should sit down and exchange ideas on guitar and stuff. And I was like,
okay.
I told him, like, I don't think I'll really be able to show you anything, but I'd love for you to show me something. He's like, I don't even know what half the stuff you're doing. I'm like, yeah, right.
Scary.
Yeah,
but amazing at the same time.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, wow, it's like such a, it's like you see him on stage and he's just tearing that guitar apart, and then he's just goofy guy backstage, just like us, and we're just like, it's, you know, it's awesome, you know, like becoming friends with idols of yours. And
definite perk of the job, isn't it?
Yeah, it's amazing. So definitely can't wait to tour with them again.
Yeah, that'd be amazing.
Yeah, that was definitely my favorite tour we've ever done so far.
Cool. Talking of tours, you've got one coming up over in the UK, I think.
Yeah.
And you're playing Brixton Academy, is that right?
Yeah.
That's pretty legendary venue over here. That's so.
Kind of what I've heard. Yeah. We played the HMV Forum last year, and then in October we played Shepherd's Bush.
That's good.
Sold out, and apparently. Yeah, I guess this is bigger than that, so that'll be cool.
It's a big deal.
Yeah.
Nerves, awesome. Or are you all right about it?
Oh,
never.
Okay,
on that
just note. Can't wait.
Good.
Go out and tear it up. Yeah.
Well, wishing you a great 2012. I've got to wrap it up now, but thank you for talking to me.
Hey, no problem.
Thank you. Thanks.